Welcome to the NYU Tandon School of Engineering for this exciting event. I am very pleased that we are launching the Center for Cybersecurity in Brooklyn, which, as you all know, is where the action is. I am especially pleased to welcome our president, Dr. Andrew Hamilton. Even before a distance of some 5,399.99 kilometers, which is the Google Map distance between his Oxford office and NYU office, and even before he assumed the responsibility for NYU, he had realized the importance of Brooklyn to the university and the importance of Brooklyn to the city as well. This augurs very well for us, those of us who are in Brooklyn. And welcome, Andy. When the old Polytechnic became part of NYU, my goal was to develop strong intellectual collaborations with the rest of the university. We could thus put our technology expertise to better serve the society. My expectations have been exceeded manifold. We now have rich collaborations with the medical school, public health, dentistry, nursing, education, business, arts, and other schools such as the Wagner School, not to mention sciences and mathematics. I'm especially pleased that the Center for Cybersecurity is the result of our ever-strengthening links with the law school at NYU, and of course the Steinhardt School as well. Rest assured that much more will come of this collaboration with the rest of NYU. I would like to thank the deans of all NYU schools, particularly Dean Trevor Morrison, for his support and the support of the central administration as well. Welcome, Mr. Trevor. I have a little more to say. My colleagues to follow, some of whom are experts in cybersecurity and who live with it day in and day out, will no doubt go into greater detail about the center and its aspirations. Needless to say, they will discuss many facets that will surround cybersecurity. In this domain, the technical issues are intertwined with issues of law and public policy. Instead of thinking about these issues separately, as many do, and as we did, in fact, until recently, the new center will examine the subject holistically, synthesize our strengths, and create new research areas and solutions in such a way that our privacy will be protected and security increased. One need not look any further than the ongoing battle between Apple and the FBI in order to understand how prevalent it is, the cybersecurity threat. And one need not go beyond the fact that many millions of efforts are made to attack corporations in the US and the world at large. The fact that only a few such attacks have been successful owes itself to the kind of people that we'll assemble here and talk about it to us. A deluge will follow unless we work very hard to stay one step ahead. In brief, this is the work of the center that is formed. They've already been working actually for some time, but formally this is the opening of the center. It represents one of the best examples of cooperation between industry, government, and academia. Ladies and gentlemen, I welcome you once again to this event and hope that more of you will get engaged with the center as days go by. And may I now invite the Dean of the Law School, Trevor Morrison, to the stage.
Thanks, Srini, and good evening to everyone. I'm really pleased to be here to help celebrate the launch of the new Center for Cybersecurity. I think it is, among many things, a terrific example of the kind of collaboration that's possible across this university, across boroughs, and between units of real strength at the university. And that this center is working in the area of cybersecurity, too, I think underscores an area of technological change, legal and policy change, really of the first order in terms of its importance today. And just as the dean of the engineering school here said, this is not an area that can be comprehensively tackled just by looking at it as a legal problem or a policy problem or a technical problem. And really an understanding of any of those individual domains, I think, requires an understanding of the others as well. I see this also as the outgrowth of a continuing collaboration, especially between our Center for Law and Security and the Computer Science Department here. Those conversations continue about future exciting collaborations. The center will be at the heart of that. I do want to thank Andy Hamilton, our president, for his support of this kind of collaboration between and among schools, and for recognizing early on, before even being in the chair, the importance of this area of cybersecurity, not just to this university, but to the country and indeed to the world. So I join with all of you in celebrating the launch of this new center. Thank you for being here. Thanks to our speakers this evening who will delve into some of the complex aspects of this set of issues. Without further ado, I want to then welcome President Hamilton to say a few words as well. Andy Hamilton.
Trevor, thank you very much indeed. And ladies and gentlemen, I am thrilled to be here this evening with all of you in launching the Center for Cybersecurity at NYU. And I just want to echo the words of the two deans. They've spoken, they've reinforced the absolute importance of this issue to 21st century USA and indeed the world. I was mentioning to Srini and to Trevor before we began that in my last months in Oxford, I was summoned with several other university vice chancellors to GCHQ. Many of you will know, though, that's the British version of the NSA, the British spooks who listen in and take great focus on cybersecurity. And it won't surprise you that their message was the message that we all know, that the world is facing very, very significant threats in cybersecurity, and in universities we have a particular responsibility to tackle these threats, to bring not only expertise on the technical challenges of cybersecurity, to also to bring our knowledge, our wisdom, our thinking around policy and legal frameworks that can apply to them, to bring them to bear, to contribute to solutions, to management, to a way of dealing with a very, very serious threat to the world. I think for me also, as Trevor said a second ago, this collaboration between Tandon and the law school really is one of a number of very, very important collaborations happening across the network, across the framework that is NYU. We are a large institution. We are a quite distributed institution when you think about our presence around New York City, here in Brooklyn, in Greenwich Village, in the Center for Health, of course, another important place where cybersecurity and patient records and their protection and confidentiality have a very significant role to play. And of course, for a university like NYU, we gain our strength from making sure that the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. And to have a collaboration of the sort we're celebrating this evening between the law school and the Tandon School of Engineering is just another example of how we can create something new, something important through collaboration and through partnership. And so I want to send a very strong note of support and endorsement for this partnership, this new initiative, this Center for Cybersecurity, and wish it all good speed in its work in the coming months and years. Thank you all.
I'm not as tall as Andy. So, good evening, and thank you so much for sharing this moment with us when we launch our new center in cybersecurity along with NYU Law. I see a lot of familiar faces in the audience. You have come and visited us every many such events over the last decade, and it's good to see you come back again and again. So I was asked to share a few words about what was the thinking behind this initiative. So we all know about the growing importance of cybersecurity, and you've heard about it from the deans and the president himself. And we ourselves read in the news about every day about data breaches, about identity theft and other financial crime that happens at a very alarming regularity. But what is more alarming is that many of these victims have been sophisticated and resourceful organizations, corporations, government agencies, etc. So even if they could not defend themselves, clearly a lot more maybe is happening. But let me not speculate on that. But one thing the understanding we get from that is that we are vulnerable. Our infrastructure is vulnerable, our financial institutions are vulnerable, our electric grid is vulnerable, and even our fundamental right to privacy is under threat. But is that new? Well, if you think about it, as humans, we've always been fragile and vulnerable. We have been vulnerable to the elements, to predators, to infections, and even to attacks by other humans. And we have devised means to protect ourselves, not just protect ourselves as individuals, but also protect ourselves as a group, as communities, and as a society. And we've done so by many different ways. One is by creating communities based on geographical proximity. And then based on treaties and a common goodwill and a mutual understanding to live and let live. We have limited harmful action by creating laws and then institutions that enforce these laws. And finally, we've even developed a sense of morality through a variety of belief systems, and they have served us well. So why do we have a problem today? I believe the problem is of scale. Methods we have so far are difficult to scale as we interconnect a world of few billion people and tens of billions of devices. And our traditional mechanisms sort of are difficult to apply because, first, the notion of geographical boundaries really is not there anymore. Cyberspace connects people from every corner of the world. So perimeter defenses such as walls and moats and fortresses and national boundaries, etc., not very effective anymore. And then laws and institutions. Well, they've served us well in physical world, but they really don't exist in cyberspace, and we don't really understand how to go about creating them and furthermore enforcing them. That seems even much harder. And moral considerations. Although they're universal, but given the great mix of ideologies and belief systems that exist in cyberspace, they're often adversarial to each other. So they do not help as well. So what do we do? I believe the solution lies in technology, the very same technology that has created cyberspace, because technology scales, right? However, what we need is not technology alone, but the right legal framework and infrastructure enabled by technology. And I believe that's what captures the essence of what we are trying to do here with the Center for Cybersecurity. It requires a deep partnership between technology and law, a type of partnership that has not been done before. At the Tandon School, we are not strangers to technology, and especially technology in cybersecurity. I can go on and on about the great things we have done, the systems that we've developed, etc. I can talk about the great educational programs we have, our Center of Excellence designations that we have from the NSA for research, education, as well as cyber ops. I can talk about Seesaw, the largest cybersecurity event run by students in the world that we run every year that had more than 30,000 participants last year. I can talk about the high school summer camps we run for high school women, summer camps we run for high school women. I can talk about the teacher training for high schools that we've been doing for the last 5 years in cybersecurity. I can talk about the research experiences we give to college faculty from all across the country in cybersecurity. And I can go on, but, and so Tandon has a deep experience and history of excellence in cybersecurity. And so is the Center for Law and Security at NYU Law. It has made great strides, and I'm sure you will hear more about them from my colleagues at NYU Law. So together, NYU Tandon and NYU Law are forming a new Center for Cybersecurity that, in partnership with public and private sector partners, will develop new approaches to security and privacy by recognizing that technology solutions alone are insufficient. CCS aims to nurture the next generation of security researchers with interdisciplinary expertise, and with your support and partnership, we are confident we can surmount the cybersecurity challenges that we face today and realize the full potential of technology as it helps shape a better world. Thank you.
Great, so thank you everybody for coming. My name is Zachary Goldman. I'm a co-founder of the center along with Nasir Memon, Ramesh Kari, Sam Raskoff, and Helen Nissenbaum. So cybersecurity is a team sport. We all understand that already. And to help demonstrate the ways in which it's a team sport, we've got six extraordinary thinkers and practitioners of cybersecurity here to engage in conversation with us this evening. So the format will be a little bit different. We'll have three pairs of new friends of the center, some affiliated with NYU, others not, to engage in short dialogues about particular subtopics, particular issues in the security discourse and dialogue today. And so they'll engage in short dialogues each, and then at the end we'll come on stage for a question and answer period. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our first pair of speakers. The first, Raj Day, we're honored to have as a distinguished fellow at NYU. He's now at Mayor Brown, where he leads the firm's global privacy and security practice. Before that, he had a sleepy tenure as the general counsel of the National Security Agency for 2012 to 2015. And we're thrilled to have Raj here this evening, and also to welcome Ted Schlein, a general partner of the Kleiner Perkins venture capital firm in Silicon Valley. As we learned earlier this afternoon, Ted literally was sort of present at the creation of some of the security products that we take for granted today, and really in some of the ways to think about security from the beginning of his career at Symantec, where he helped create commercial antivirus software, and then later on at Kleiner Perkins, where he's helped nurture some of the security companies that we all think about and use every day. So please, Raj and Ted, join us, and thank you again, everybody, for coming.
So thanks all for coming. I thought we'd start out just with some basics, since we're the first pair up here. And when I was at the NSA, we had pretty good visibility into the threat landscape, the cyber threat landscape. And I think one thing everybody can agree on is it's pretty complex, and perhaps more complex than ever before in terms of the threat actors involved, nation states, criminal groups, the tactics used, and the types of attacks that happen, destructive attacks, stealing of information, et cetera. Ted, you've been in this space for a long time, one decade at Symantec, 2 decades investing in cybersecurity technology. Tell us a little bit about the evolution that you've seen in this space and how the threat landscape has impacted the technology and the business landscape.
Well, if you think back to, I'd say, the late 80s when I first got involved, most of the threat landscape were kind of hobbyists that sort of just wanted to mess with you a little bit. Maybe put up a message on your computer and sort of play with you to some extent. You got to realize it. It wasn't until you started to get local area networks where any of these things could be passed around a little bit, and then finally you had to connect to the internet for things to truly be passed in any great quantity. And you fast forward from the times where you had the hobbyist to go across a few decades where we are today, Let me. I'll stop for a second there. So in between, you kind of had a period of time where most of the damage was sort of tactical and might have cost you some money, right? They brought down a server. You got to fix it. You got to spend some money to fix it. And now you fast forward to today, where the type of damage that takes place could be catastrophic and quite strategic. In some cases, CEOs of public companies losing their jobs. Which is kind of a seminal event in the world of cybersecurity. And so the threat landscape continued to evolve. The stakes just kept going up and up and up. It became a wonderful business, right? The money involved was enormous for the bad guys. So it was a kind of a great business to be in. Nation states got heavily involved. And the number of attack vectors, i.e., all these little things that we carry around with us now and in the future, you know, the Internet of Things devices and all sort of different ways to come into the scene, just kind of multiply what the potential threat landscape is. So all in all, it's become far more complicated. The bad guys have gotten smarter, better funded, and it's a much better business for them.
So with that depressing start, I guess the question is, what do we do about it? And you've seen a lot of technologies over your time investing. What are the technologies or the companies that excite you the most and that I think provide the most promise for the future in your view?
We're moving into a new landscape now where we were sort of in a world of preventative, and we sort of developed a whole lot of preventative medicine, how to stop bad guys from coming into our networks. And we're sort of have shifted into more of a detection mode. So we've gone from prevent to detect. And what's that? It's kind of a realization that for the most part, the bad guys are probably going to get in. And so what we need to do is find them as fast as humanly possible, contain it, and then remediate. That's a big mind shift. That's a big change. We've also are moving from being a signature-based methodology, meaning let's look for bad things and stop those bad things from entering our networks. We're going to move from looking for signatures to looking for interesting pieces of information and data and processing that data through models that sort of tell us, hey, this is a good behavior, this is a bad behavior. This is abnormal. I'm going to try and figure this one out. Rather than being so definitive about, hey, here's a signature I've seen before, let's stop it. And that's going to bring on a whole new wave of sort of security analytics companies that probably will do a much better job than the signature-based methodologies for dealing with these problems. I think a second thing that I think is highly pertinent, especially to the center, is as an industry, we've been very much on our heels and kind of deflecting the bad guys. And I actually think we're going to need to lean forward. And we're going to have to get more preemptive. And what does that mean? It kind of makes people a little uncomfortable because I do think it means that our best defense might be a really good offense. And that's going to be a mixture of innovation, but it's also going to mean policy. There's going to have to be changes in how we perceive how might we fight back. And I'm not proposing like complete anarchy and everyone just starting to hack back everyone else. I believe that we're going to need to figure out a way to within the rights of the law be able to bring the fight to the bad guy a little bit more. And that's why I think a center like this is going to be so important. If you look at some of the testimony from just even the Apple case, it's quite obvious that a technology background and a law background are going to be necessary. When you look at some of the questions about, you know, was encryption invented with the iPhone? They need a little help.
A long way to go. Well. You've been involved, as many as you probably know, with some of the biggest names in the industry, whether it's Symantec, Mandiant, LifeLock, and at one point, every incumbent was a startup. So what advice would you have to folks looking at the startup landscape? How can startups distinguish themselves from the big players in this space?
Well, one great thing about the security industry and why I've been in it for so long is everyone is always looking to be more secure, and they're willing to take chances on little guys that come up with innovative solutions that solve a new problem. The problem with some of the bigger guys is they kind of get complacent in the way that they solve the problems. And the bad guys are pretty innovative. They've got a lot of resources, and so the innovation is necessary. Now, to get above the noise, you gotta truly do something that's different. You need to show that it's different. You gotta get your first few customers that are willing to stand up there and shout with you from the rooftops. Hey, you gotta take notice. But it's one of the few areas really in the enterprise software world where you can be a little guy and kind of jump out pretty quickly and get to the top because you've come up with solving a problem. Once again, you got people's lives at stake. You have companies that say you got their brands at stake. You have, and we just talked about somebody's job potentially at stake. So a lot of times they're willing to give the little guy a good chance.
And, you know, today a lot of the dialogue is about the relationship between the government and the tech sector. But on this issue of innovation, can the government play a positive role in innovation? You sit on the board of trustees of InQtel. And for those who don't know, that is an organization that was founded by the intelligence community to help spur innovation. What role do you think the government has in spurring innovation, or is the government now really a follower?
Well, you gotta remember, the government started DARPA. and much of the Silicon Valley has been built from what's come out of DARPA. And so, you know, far be it for anyone in Silicon Valley to ever sort of say the government cannot spur innovation. I certainly am not going to go there. I think that they can play a great role in the area of R&D, whether it be to help fund research in the educational institutions around the country, which are great at doing some of that core R&D. I do think. It may be up to others to commercialize the R&D, and that's certainly what we do very well in Silicon Valley and elsewhere in the startup world to bring the commercialization. You know, the role at InQtel is really about finding commercial technologies and bringing it back into government for them to utilize for to accomplish their own goals and their own issues. So I do think the government all along has played an important role in innovation, and I would hope that we continue to do so. I'd love to see more money flow for R&D purposes.
Now, before we came out, we were speaking a little bit about the value of crossover between policymakers, technologists, lawyers, and the beauty of a center like this, for example. And you were telling us that you often visit DC for a variety of reasons to meet with policymakers. If you could convey one lesson to policymakers on how to help innovation and technology, is there something that stands out, some lesson you try to impart, regardless of the visit, that you'd like to leave policymakers with?
How long is this interview? the key is policymakers tend to react to situations. And in the world of technology, we live with our answers for a very long time. And it can have pretty long ramifications if we react to a situation too rashly or too abruptly. So it's mostly trying to get them to pause, listen to multiple sides of a situation, truly try and understand the situation before we come up with, do we need legislation? Do we have to do something? I think I spent over a decade on cyber policy. I don't know if that was a decade well spent or not, but it was mostly just trying to make sure they understand what will work, what will matter, what might not matter, as I said, not be knee jerk. And Washington very often is an area that has knee jerk reactions to the situation at hand of the day. And that can have some pretty long-term impact on our industry. So it's usually a message around that if there's not a particular issue that we're talking about.
Well, For those of you who don't know Ted, he's never going to shy away from a controversial issue. So speaking of issue of the day, one issue that's percolating in even my house is the Apple FBI standoff. And for those of you, if you have to be living under a rock to not really have followed this, but effectively, the FBI is asking for access to a particular iPhone in the San Bernardino case in California. Can you share with us your thoughts on the current situation and if you have any view as to how this policy discussion should progress?
Gosh, you're the first to ask me this, Raj. Well, sure, I guess if you mix my last answer with this answer, you kind of get the answer, which is please do not sit there in the Senate, in the House, and think you're going to go argue with one another and come up with the answer to this problem. Do not put this through the courts and think you're going to actually come up with an answer to this issue. This is a big long-term issue that we need to solve as an industry, and a short-term fix will not do it. And so they're obviously using the San Bernardino case as the case to argue, but it's really about setting precedents. I think it's somewhat unprecedented to ask a private company to go develop some proprietary piece of software to go break their own technology. At least I'm not aware of it. I'm not a lawyer, but that's a little unprecedented. Yet, all of us as citizens, whether you're in the technology world or elsewhere, would like to be good citizens and help the country in terms of national security. So let's get the right people in the room to come up with the right compromises, but weakening our security architecture is not going to be one of the compromises. You know, it just won't work. Any broad-based solution towards weakening encryption doesn't work technically, it doesn't keep us safer, and it certainly will hurt us negatively from an economic standpoint. That's general. I just like to get it off the front pages, and let's get it in the back room, and let's go work out a solution that's going to work for both the technology industry and for law enforcement, and I'm quite certain that we can do it.
I'd like to turn to a separate topic because it comes up both in my legal practice and I'm sure in your daily life. So you sit on a number of boards of directors for companies you invest in, and boards more and more these days of public companies, if not private companies, are concerned about cybersecurity and the risk to brand reputation and so forth. How much do you think boards of directors are getting right these days? How much are they getting wrong? If you could provide one piece of advice to a public company board director, given your knowledge of the industry, what would it be?
As it pertains to security in particular? Well, what's interesting is security is being discussed in public boards now. And that once again, if I come back to it, the Target CEO firing was kind of the precipitator to this. It was not really a topic in board. Maybe the security officer would come and brief a public board once a year kind of thing, but it was not a general topic. Now you have boards that are looking at the CEO saying, so how secure are we? And the CEO looks over at the CIO and sort of says, so how secure are we? And the CIO looks over at the CISO and says, how secure are we? And the CISO has no one else to look at, so they got to look at the board and answer the question. And I always thought the question was kind of the wrong question. It really isn't about how secure we. It's sort of, how vulnerable are we in a way. So that fact that the topic is being brought up, I do believe that public boards are going to probably in the future have security experts on those boards. I don't know if they're going to be in audit committees or where they're going to be, but I think that there's going to be a necessity to some level of understanding security and security issues on the boards that didn't exist before. Once again, because if something were to happen, it can pose significant risk to shareholders. And so they can't afford not to have that, if for another reason, as a checklist that they have them on their public boards.
Can existing board members educate themselves sufficiently to at least understand the issue, or is this really such a specialized area, one needs to bring in experts to handle it, in your view?
Well, I think you can learn something at certainly a superficial level quickly. I mean, I've sat with a lot of very smart folks, and they can get the general concept. So it's sort of, as a board member, your main goal is to know what questions to ask, right? I mean, you're not there to run a company. You're there to ask management hard questions. And so as a board member, do I think you could learn what hard questions to ask? Yes. But will you know how to interpret the answer? That probably is going to take more time.
You spoke a little bit earlier of some of the trends we've been seeing, one of which is a move away from signature-based detection and attacks to more either big data analytics, behavioral analysis, that sort of thing. Does that have implications for the policy framework within which we're operating? So for example, Congress just passed, I'm sure you're all aware, something called the Cybersecurity Information Sharing Act, which was really built on a model of sharing traditional types of threat indicators between businesses and with the government. So if that's starting to be the old world, do you think that'll be effective in this new world, or are there different types of policy changes we should be looking for?
Well, on that particular one, look, I'm glad the government has done something. It took them a long time to get to that act. I get asked about it, and I usually sort of say that it's good and not sufficient. We'll see how many people share information and what kind of benefit people derive from it in the future. But I think that the next administration is going to be dealing with cyber policies for a long time. And if you just take it, how about when is it okay for us to use cyber weapons? In what case? In what amount of force? What's the right amount of force depending upon what the attack was? Does it have to be a kinetic attack to use a cyber weapon in return? Do you use cyber weapons for economic gain? Do you should private industry be protected by any kind of offensive cyber means? Right. I mean, here's an interesting thing. So you have private companies, private enterprises, that are breached by nation states, and now those private enterprises are then have class action lawsuits against them because people's data got stolen and they got breached. Well, is it really fair to assume that a private enterprise should be able to protect themselves against a nation state, or should? Should the U.S. government help the private enterprise, or is this really about tort reform, or whatever the right law reform is in there? But so I just think we have so many new issues that still haven't been answered. What is positive attribution? How positive does attribution have to be? Do you have to know the actual IP address or the individual, or the address of the individual, or do you got to know what unit they come from? And I just rattle off a whole lot of things. So.
Well, I think that'll take up the next administration. So I think we're out of time, but if I could just leave you with one last question and we'll wrap it up. You recently interviewed Secretary of Defense Ash Carter and asked him some of these same sorts of questions. Was there something he said to you that you think was particularly interesting or worth sharing in the policy context, the role of DOD when it comes to cyber, offensive cyber, deterrence, those sorts of issues?
Well, on this last topic that we're talking about, the secretary, we started talking about this topic, and the secretary said, I'm paraphrasing, but something along the lines that an attack on a private industry is an attack on America. And he takes that very seriously. I'm not going to intimate what he meant by that or where that goes, et cetera. But I find that sort of fascinating. Well, if you take that as a launching point, what might we do with our capabilities? And I think we ought to take our capabilities very seriously. I mean, I don't think we ought to be igniting some cyber arms race. That would be bad for the country as well. So getting this balance right, I think, is just going to be really, really important for the country. And it's also, I'll bring it back around to the very beginning, why I really applaud a center like this being established. because I think it's going to take a lot of really smart people, both from the law side and the engineering side and probably a couple different other areas, disciplines as well, to help us sort through some of these topics and some of these areas in the future. That I don't think there's any one obvious answer, but we're going to have to start coming up with some answers.
Well, thank you, and please join me in thanking Ted.